Good morning, friends. Today is Good Friday, and we gather wherever we may be to worship Jesus, who was crucified between two revolutionaries on a hill just outside the city of Jerusalem. This morning's worship service has been planned to take you through the fading hours of Jesus' life on the cross. Even as he uttered his last words seven times, this morning we recapture the poignancy of those moments. May God's Spirit speak to each one of us as we worship God on this holy day. First word that Jesus uttered from the cross is taken from Luke, Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, reading from verses 32 to 38. Two other men, both criminals, were led out with Jesus to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified Jesus along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus then said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was written a notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." Jesus stood in the hall of the high priest's palace, being mocked by men who crowded about him. He was struck, he was cursed, he was reviled, but Jesus uttered no rebuke. Jesus was placed before the council of the high priest. Men gave false witness against him, condemned him, spat upon him, struck him with rods. Jesus made no murmur. Jesus was then brought before the profligate Herod and the vacillating Pilate. He was mocked with a robe, royal robe, a crown of thorns, and yet Jesus patiently submitted. Jesus was then hurried away amid jeers and curses to the hill just outside Jerusalem called Golgotha. He was flung to the ground and beaten. The soldiers gambled for his clothes. It was only then that Christ spoke. And what did he say? Did he condemn? Did he curse? Were the words that came from Jesus' mouth words of bitterness? No. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do or what they're doing." You see, friends, Jesus' whole life was punctuated by his compassion for others. Jesus was committed to bring about reconciliation between humanity and God. And so even in his dying moments of his life, Jesus only knew love. Jesus only knew compassion. In this pain, in this agony, Jesus is able to say, "Father, forgive them." Was Jesus excusing their actions? By no means. He was not implying their innocence, because the very prayer says, "Father, forgive them, for they are guilty." But it was his unfathomable love, his commitment to do the will of God in bringing about peace between humanity and God. And you will remember, friends, that Jesus' whole ministry, in his whole ministry, he spoke about loving your enemies, blessing those who curse you, and doing good to those who hate you. In fact, in the prayer that we utter so often, "Our Father who art in heaven," Jesus taught his disciples to pray, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us." Peter asked, "How many times must I forgive someone?" And Jesus told him, "Forgive without limit." So friends, this first word that Jesus uttered from the cross was a word that brought humanity back to God. It was a word that exemplified Jesus' love for humanity. May we emulate the dying Christ in this love that he had for humanity. May we have that love. Jesus said, "Love one another as I have loved you." Amen.
Far away, stood an old ragged cross. Luke chapter 23, verses 39 to 43. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." So in this passage we have Jesus being crucified in between two criminals. And let's be clear, those criminals weren't there for stealing a loaf of bread. They probably murdered somebody, maybe robbed and murdered somebody. They've done pretty bad stuff. So whilst Jesus was living, he lived amongst the unlovely. He moved amongst the prostitutes, the tax collectors, the lepers, people that nobody else wanted to associate with. And this is how he died as well. One of the criminals heckles Jesus and he says, "Hey, if you really are the Messiah, then why can't you get us out of here? Get us off this crucifix." Bit like the devil, really, when Jesus is tempted in the wilderness. "If you are the Son of God, then." Bit like our society today. If there is a God, why is there suffering? You know. The other criminal confronts him, saying, "Look, we've done something wrong. We deserve this punishment. But he's innocent. He has done nothing to deserve this." And in saying that, he's saying, "Look, I realize that what I've done is wrong, that I have committed a sin. I'm not innocent." But when he turns to Jesus and says, "Remember me when you go into your kingdom," it means, therefore, that he sees Jesus as the Messiah, that he has faith in him, that he believes in him. So Jesus then replies that, "Yes, you will be in heaven with me." And this conversation says so much. It says anyone, no matter what they've done, can be part of the kingdom, can come to Christ, can be forgiven. It's a matter of saying sorry for what they've done, and like he did, and having faith in Jesus. Before I finish, I want to share one other thing about this passage and how it actually changed my life. On hearing this story many years ago, I went from being a Christian who, the extent of my faith was to say, "Oh, on a census form, I would pick, yeah, I'm a Christian," to someone now who is a disciple, I think. I try to be. Jesus would have been in agony on the cross. Crucifixion was a particularly agonizing way to die, an awful, prolonged torture. And even though he was suffering like this, Jesus could turn to this other man and have a conversation and have compassion and show love to him. Even though he was someone who, well, society would have thought he wasn't worthy of that love. On hearing that, I wanted to follow Jesus. I wanted to be like Jesus insofar as I wanted to be able to love people like that, even when I was suffering. I've got a long way to go. But I guess it's a journey for all of us, and there are things that we can do now to be the Christ light in this world at the moment, which is in such despair and in such stress. We could still listen to people so that the fear in their heart subsides. We can show them love in that way. And we can listen to those in fear, and we can provide help for the vulnerable, maybe even food or a phone call to make sure they're okay. There's so much we can do. And we're not like Jesus and nowhere near it. But, hey, that's who I want to follow. Thank you. God bless.
come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
When we see Mary at the foot of the cross and Jesus addressing her, in my mind, I'm amazed. Amazed at the capacity in the midst of agonizing pain for Jesus to think of his mother and to give her care to John, the beloved disciple. It's the image of a good son, an eldest son, to care for his mother, especially that she is most certainly a widow by now. Mary's relationship with Jesus has been complicated by layers of experience. Mary, the mother, has faded from the story of the ministry of Jesus following the sending of the brothers to bring him home because they feared for his sanity and perhaps feared the influence of the ruling priests. Mary, his mother, now appears again in the last scene of death. How was she now in Jerusalem for the trial and execution? Didn't she still live up in Capernaum by the Sea of Galilee? As a woman, she couldn't travel the road safely and alone. So which brothers brought her to the city and didn't turn up for the execution? Were they worried that they too were at risk by their brother's entry to Jerusalem on a donkey like a king? The mother would be loyal to him and perceived as no threat to the Romans, a widow, survivor, at the foot of the cross, and some other women with her, her sister, Mary, wife of Clopas, Mary Magdalene. Witnessing a horror, the worst death imaginable for a woman to see in her child. A mother will forgive you almost anything. It must have torn her heart. A mother will support her son in his distress and be a loyal face in the crowd. Did she gaze at his hands, which once produced beautiful pieces of craftsmanship in wood, now curled in agony? Hands that curled in infancy as fists against her breast while he fed. Did she keep her eyes on his face to support him even as tears coursed down her own? Did she collapse and wail in grief at the foot of the cross, covering herself with dust and tearing her clothes? And what did she believe about her son at this time? She was not one of the women at the tomb on Sunday morning. That Mary was Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James Zebedee, that is, and Salome. For whatever reason, Mary, the mother of Jesus, is not named as being part of the group who go to anoint the body. Mary Magdalene is consistently named as being part of that group in each gospel. And, of course, Peter and John had to go and verify what was seen there for themselves. Mary is at the foot of the cross for her son's death, taken home by John, not there on the resurrection, left behind to grieve in the house where John was staying. Possibly there on the day of Pentecost when the Spirit fell on 120 believers in the upper room. She will live in a place which is often full of apostles and new believers. Imagine what she saw and heard. She will continue to serve in cooking and cleaning, washing, spinning, perhaps growing food, perhaps up in Capernaum, while John came home. The story of the resurrection is strong without Mary the mother in it. In all four Gospels, they have swept her out of the picture. Mary Magdalene is a picture of the new Gospel and is centre stage as witness to the resurrection and the new church. So some commentators say that Mary represents the history of the Jewish people and Mary Magdalene and John represent the new heritage of Christianity. God has a mothering heart, which we would do well to remember when we think of Mary. God forgives us like a mother standing with us in grief and pain. God forgives us like a mother. God forgives us like the depths of the ocean, like the unfathomable depths of the universe. God forgives us again and again, like a mother. And Mary, mother of Jesus, mother of the incarnation of God made flesh, the Christ bearer, she is like the mothering side of God too, loving endlessly, calling us home, forgiving us again and again. So Mary is an image of the mothering heart of God.
Good morning, Nedlands. My name is Randy Solomon. I'm your new youth and young adults coordinator. Welcome to the service this morning. I'm going to start off right away with the scriptures. We're going to be reading from Mark chapter 15, verses 33 to 36. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with vine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone, and let's see if Elijah comes down," he said. I want to talk a little bit about the whole Jesus calling out God, Father, Dad, why have you forsaken me? And one of the things that I was reflecting on is that quite often we just, there seems to be a right time to say something and a wrong time to say something, or like, why did it take so long to say something? And in this case, I have a real sense, like for myself, I have a real sense of why did Jesus leave it so long to have this sense that God had forsaken him. I mean, he had so many reasons. In the last sort of in the last 24 hours of his life, prior to being at that point where he yelled that out, he had one of his friends completely betray him, sell him out for silver. He was arrested. And when he was arrested, all his friends ran away. Nobody sort of stuck around at all. One of his closest friends disowned him, claimed that they didn't even know him. The guy that had betrayed him actually took his own life, hung himself from a tree. When the general public, who not that long ago had hailed him as a king on Palm Sunday, when given the choice between him and Barnabas, who was a basically a political rebel rouser that had very few things that he wouldn't be willing to do, Barnabas was chosen instead of him to release. And that was, there was political motivation behind that, but still, like the crowds, everybody was behind him, not behind him. He seemed to have no friends. He seemed to have no connections. He seemed to have no lifelines. The soldiers mocked him and spit on him and beat him. And then he was nailed to a cross. And at every one of those stages, in myself, I would wonder why God would have forsaken me in those situations. When one of my friends betrays me, or I think somebody's got my back and they don't. Like that sense of, well, God, why, where are you in this? I mean, if you get arrested, not arrested for something that you've actually done, those are consequences, like you can understand that. But if all of a sudden somebody just showed up at your door for no reason, the police showed up at your door for no reason and just arrested you, where would you, like, how would you be sort of processing that and saying, "Hey God, why is this happening? Like, why are you forsaking me in this sort of thing?" And particularly in relationships where you might be experiencing breakdown in relationships, all that sort of stuff, and you kind of go, God, how, like, this is important stuff. Like, where are you in this? And why have you forsaken this situation? And then when it just comes down to the downright just ugly mocking and beating and just abusing you as a person or as a person, why would God allow that to happen? And yet it's not until the very end, it's not until that moment in time that prior to that's been looking forward to and after that we've been looking back to, that's put the finishing touches on the new covenant with us so that God can have an ongoing relationship with us, that Jesus cries out and sort of says, God, why have you forsaken me at this point? And as we understand that our ugliness and our ability not to understand, our inability to understand that God wants to be beside us through all the good and the bad, our ability to abandon people and our friends, our ability to disown things that we should be owning up to, it's in those times, all of that, when that got piled on Christ, as he was nailed on the cross dying, that God had to turn away for a while and let Jesus do the job. And wow, how would we be in that place where God would have to forsake us? It's the most amazing point in the Christian church's history, as far as I'm concerned. And yeah.
With me when I fear. My eyes shall then behold you, upon your cross shall dwell. My heart by faith enfold you, and who dies thus dies well.
I thirst. John 19, verses 28 to 29. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said in order to fulfill the scripture, I am thirsty. A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth.
I want you to close your eyes. Imagine a time that you were really, really thirsty. What was happening? What did you think of? How did you feel? Open your eyes. Were you longing for a nice, cool glass of water? In fact, was that longing so great it was almost an obsession? This Good Friday, we are looking at Jesus' final words on the cross. We study these final words because we believe in their importance and significance. It cost Christ so much to deliver these words to us in the midst of his anguish and great suffering. So why I thirst? Well, firstly, it reminds us of Jesus' humanity. Jesus was God and man. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, it says, since therefore the children share in the flesh and the blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has power over death, that is, the devil. So by saying, I thirst, Jesus reminds us of his humanity. Secondly, we read in this passage of scripture that Jesus is fulfilling prophecy. Jesus himself cries out from the cross, parts of Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? I encourage you this Easter to read through the entirety of Psalm 22 to see the relevance to the Easter story. Also in Psalm 69, verse 21, we read, they put gall in my food and gave me vinegar for my thirst. But it's not just these scriptures in Psalms that Christ is fulfilling on the cross. It's many others that we find in the Old Testament prophets, particularly Isaiah. I'm also wondering whether it also is a reflection of Jesus' time in the Garden of Gethsemane. We read that just before Jesus was arrested, he went to the garden to pray. And while he was there, he asked the Father, please take this cup from me. But he also prayed, your will be done. So I am wondering when Jesus calls out, I thirst here, it's also symbolic of his acceptance and readiness for the next part of his mission. Jesus was fulfilling a mission on the cross, which he knew was coming to its time. And thirdly, Jesus still had more to say, as you will hear from our next two speakers. Did Jesus need a drink so that it would enable him to utter his final words, it is finished, on the cross? And finally, it's odd that Jesus, who in John chapter 4 said to the woman at the well, I am the water of life, and that those who drink of me will have no need of water ever again. And yet here Jesus is on the cross saying, I thirst. But is Jesus reminding us here and now that in times of great agony, incredible distress, that we cry out to God for help? And that brings me to thinking about what does this mean for life today? And I'm reminded of the thirst that our nation has,
We've seen massive droughts across Australia, which had a great impact on the bushfires that swept across our nation earlier this year. And now too, we see not just a physical thirst for water, but as people are struggling with the epidemic and how to live in a time of incredible uncertainty, we too need to cry out to God, the living water.
Dear friends, brothers, sisters in Christ, we know that the phrase, "it is finished," is the second last word Jesus said right before he stepped on the cross. But before anything goes, I would like all of us to picture this image. It was in Golgotha's Hill, which means a place of sky. The time was the third hour of afternoon, and the sun had stopped shining. The darkness came over the whole land. Remember the tortures that Jesus endured? He had first been flogged, then a crown of thorns set on his head. He has been repeatedly struck on the head with a staff before he was finally handed over to be crucified. Then Jesus was nailed onto the cross at the third hour, left for 6 hours to bleed to death upon the cross. After the ninth hour arrived, a voice was heard, "It is finished." Now let us pause for a second. What do you feel when you hear the phrase, "It is finished"? Do you feel like someone is in control of what he's doing? Or someone is satisfied in completing a task? Can you sense any trace of despair or any wave of hope? Or might be a sense of relief? Certainly, the meaning behind "it is finished" suggests a final ending has come for whatever task has been carried out. For Jesus, his last word affirmed accomplishment of the work for which he was called to do on earth, a manifestation of the Father's will in his life. But for us, this set the everlasting sail for the completion of the Father's intended salvation for all mankind. And now the work of Jesus on the cross is completed. But what has that got to do with us today? I believe the answer lies in Jesus' word to the woman who had lived a sinful life. "Your sins are forgiven. Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Just as Mary Magdalene knelt at the feet of the cross with the joy of clean heart, clear mind, and innocent body, we too have become a whole new person in Christ. This revelation prompted Mary to put her trust in Jesus, to pour the expensive perfume on Jesus' feet and wipe his feet with her hair, and to follow Jesus all the way to the cross on Golgotha. How then should I respond? I can only say, "Thank you, Jesus," and continue to walk on this faith journey of learning to place my trust in him for the rest of my life. Here, I would like to conclude some messages from above. 1. Jesus knew what he has been called and sent by the Father. And 2. Jesus found his identity and the plan the Father had for him, as we read in the Old Testament. 3. Jesus trusted God and carried out the will of the Father all the way, even to the point of dying on the cross. And alas, Jesus was certain of his completion of the task the Father had intended for him to do. Just as Apostle Paul was then, he declared, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith." Friends, brothers and sisters, is there something in these messages speaking to you and me now? Let us continue to build each one up with the love modeled by Jesus, and may his finished work continue to manifest in our life. May God bless us all. In Jesus' name. Amen.
The very last words that Jesus spoke before his crucifixion are found in the Gospel of Luke, and those words are, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." I'm sure that most of us, if not all of us, have been deeply moved by the actions of those who are willing to risk their own lives in order to save the lives of others. In our own time, we've heard about the men and women who risked their lives in the face of terrible bushfires. Some of those people died. And the people also who see something terrible happening on the roads and streets and have risked their lives by intervening. And then the doctors and nurses who do their very best to help people who have the coronavirus. And it's not so long ago that 17 schoolboys in Thailand were rescued by an Australian doctor and a dentist who risked their own lives with the help of other people. It would be possible to go on with many examples of great heroism in times of war and in times of peace, in times of natural disasters and in times when people gave their lives in order that others might live, without counting the cost of what they were doing. But when we come to the story of Good Friday, we are confronted by heroism and sacrifice at a much higher level than any of the examples that I have mentioned. For Jesus knew that he would have to experience the terrible pain of all that took place both before and during his death on the cross. But he also knew that he would soon be in the hands of God. And forever after, people would know that his death was the pathway to the love and forgiveness of God. It was Paul who, in a letter to the Christians in Rome, pointed out, quoting this, "One will hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps a good man will even dare to die. But God shows his love for us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Amen.
In the cross of Christ I glory, towering all the wrecks of time. All the light of sacred story gathers round its head sublime. Through the cross Christ's love empowers us, worldliness and self-deny. By his Spirit it inspires us, him through love to glorify. When the woes of life o'ertake us, hopes deceive and fears annoy, never shall the cross forsake us, from it shines our peace and joy. Pain and blessing, pain and pleasure, by the cross are sanctified. Peace is there that knows no measure, joys that through all time abide.
Friends, as we come to the close of this Good Friday service, may we continue to reflect on the final utterances of Jesus from the cross and what this must mean for us. What message this gives to us in the context of our Christian discipleship. So let me lead you in a final prayer before I give the benediction. Let us pray. O God, on this day in the Christian calendar, we pause to reflect on the supreme sacrifice of Christ our Savior on the cross, on this hill at Golgotha. Lord, as we have heard the words from Scripture and the preaching of those words, we remember your humility, your grace. We remember your commitment toward the mission that you have ahead of you. And even as we leave this place after having worshipped you, Lord, we ask that you continue to shine your light into our lives. May we reflect not just the crucified Christ, but the risen Christ in our lives, that our lives may be a blessing to others, that, O God, through the words that we utter, the lives that we live, and the examples that we are to human beings, your name may be glorified. This prayer we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, whom we love and serve. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon each one of us, our families and loved ones, this Good Friday and through Eastertide, and always. Amen.